Welcome to part two of our trade series lectures. Today, we will continue to discuss the effects Silk Road trade had for the post-classical period. This trade route itself became known for the principal good traded along this route, silk. Silk making was a guarded secret in China, and it was actually illegal for silk merchants to divulge any of the silk making process to foreigners, so all of the secrets remained in China. The Silk Road will be largely dependent on imperial stability. A stable government means roads are well maintained and policed. A failing empire means the roads are more susceptible to banditry and less people will be trading. These Silk Roads are created to connect people stretching as far as China all the way to the Roman Empire. Of course, there is more than one road that leads to China. The most common route starts in the capital of China at the time, Chang'an, and from there it heads west towards the Talamakan Desert. When translated, Talamakan means, "He who enters does not come back out." Pretty ominous. So obviously, no one wants to go straight through the desert, so all travelers will choose to go around it. You can see this route on the map right under where it says Turkestan. One route will go over the desert and the other goes under. The two routes will meet back up in Kashgar, which is the westernmost corner of modern China. The end of this main route will terminate at the Mediterranean Sea in present-day Turkey or in present-day Lebanon. Other routes will go on to the Byzantine capital of Constantinople, another major trade city during this time period. I think there are some common misconceptions about the Silk Road. One of the largest ones is that trade only really went one way. Like, China and India were the only places that had goods people wanted. A great example of items that were sought after from the Mediterranean are things like the glass jar shown in this picture. The Romans had a specific glass blowing technique that was highly valued in other regions, so not all goods traded on the Silk Road will come out of Asia. Other items traveling along the Silk Road will be currency. As long as it's made out of gold or silver, it doesn't really matter whose currency it was. The picture on the left shows a Byzantine coin that was excavated from a Chinese tomb, which again goes to show that foreign currency was much more widely accepted than what we'd have in present-day times. It's important to remember that long-distance trade is not organized by a single person. Trade was divided into smaller segments. If you were a merchant, you probably spent your whole career traveling back and forth on the same short section of road between your town and the towns surrounding you. Tariffs and taxes on goods that move through towns help pay for the safety of the road. If you were a local official, you would want to make your area as safe as possible to increase business. The more merchants coming through your town, the more money your town is making. While merchants are traveling, they often needed places to stay overnight. If you were traveling with valuable goods, odds are you wouldn't want to sleep out in the open with no protection. So, towns along the Silk Road started building caravanserais, like the one in the picture. Think of them as early hotels. You would pay for the use of a large room that you could lock your goods and livestock in safely for the night. This particular caravanserai is from Cairo, Egypt's most important trade city. So while this one's in Egypt, most of them around the Silk Road looked pretty similar to this. They're usually made out of stone for safety purposes, and they often had a kind of trough area or a fountain in the middle, so it was really easy to water your animals. Of course, goods are not the only things traveling along the Silk Road. Ideas will travel as well. The major concept that will travel due to trade is Buddhism. As merchants travel through India, they are greeted by peaceful and welcoming Buddhist monks. Monks would often open up their monasteries and allow merchants to stay there. This increases contact with Buddhism, and it will enable more and more merchants to convert to the religion. Buddhism will start to spread further along the Silk Road due to these merchant communities. From around 200 BCE to 700 CE, Buddhism will be the dominant faith of the Silk Road. This is also where we start to see the transition of Buddhism as a philosophy or way of life to the Buddha taking on a more godlike quality. From the time period of around 200 BCE to 400 CE, the three major world religions will be Buddhism, Hinduism, and Christianity. As you can see on this map, Buddhism is the red line there, and it's spreading northeast. and a little bit southeast as well. Hinduism, the purple is really only spreading a tiny bit southeast. It mostly stays in India. And Christianity in the green is mostly only going west. You do see it reach Persia, but not. It doesn't have as large of a presence. The next concept I want to discuss today is the concept of syncretism. For our purposes, we will define syncretism as the merging or assimilation of several originally discrete traditions. This is a word I guarantee you will see on your AP exam. Basically, what it means is that as ideas spread, they will be reflected differently with influences from the culture already present in the areas they spread to. The Buddha's changing image is a great example of syncretism. When Buddhism reaches China, the people there will present him with more Chinese features. This is a carving of a Buddha from a cave in Yongyang in 460 CE. This next image is an early Buddhist sculpture from Bactria, and you can see the Buddha looks much more Mediterranean. He is wearing what resembles a toga and has more Caucasian features, and even has that curly hair that was so popular of a style for that time period. These changes to the Buddha are great examples of syncretism to the Buddhist faith. A new religion that develops due to Silk Road trade will be a new faith called Manichaeism. It all starts in 216 CE in Iran with a guy named Mani, who was originally a devout Zoroastrian. He strongly identified with the teachings of Zoroaster, the Buddha, and Jesus, but he felt that they were incomplete. He believed he was also a prophet, like his idols, and his message was for the entire world. He called his teachings the Religion of Light. He will borrow a lot of dualism that should seem very familiar to you. You know, the whole good versus evil, light versus dark, spirit versus matter, all things that, his idols put into their own religions. So because Mani incorporates so many concepts that people are already used to, he gains followers pretty quickly. The most devout followers were called the elect. They lived an ascetic lifestyle. Ascetic basically means that they had severe self-discipline, they abstained from all forms of indulgence, and they're going to practice celibacy and vegetarianism as well. And they have a life strongly based off of prayer and fasting. This type of lifestyle is geared only to the most devout of followers. Manichaeism spreads at an extraordinary speed. It reaches Rome by 280 CE and made it to China around 700 CE. Manichaeism was perhaps most unpopular around the region it began in, and originally ran into conflict with the Zoroastrian faith, and then later, after the introduction of Islam, they were even further persecuted in these areas. Mani himself will die after being tried for opposing his local church and state. Through persecution and not many people wanting to be homeless ascetic monks, Manichaeism will die out sometime around the 14th century. Along with the spread of goods, culture, and people also comes disease. The big name diseases spread were illnesses like smallpox, measles, and the bubonic plague. What made this spread worse was that many of these diseases were being spread to places with no previous exposure to them, meaning they had no immunity built up, and the diseases became ultimately fatal for anyone that got it. The major effect of the spread of disease will be an economic slowdown. The population is growing smaller, and there are not as many people able to produce or trade goods. The demand for foreign luxury goods will go down, and communities will move towards becoming more self-sufficient. Just to give you an idea of how greatly the population is affected worldwide, if you look at China's population in this chart, they lose around 15 million people to epidemics, while the Romans, on the right, lose about 20 million people. We will go more into depth on these population effects in later episodes. This completes part 2 of our Silk Road Trade series. Thanks for watching!